about the manners in Islam. And I like to remind myself and remind everyone here, Jazakumullah khair, that Allah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you in attending the classes, seeking the knowledge for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a great deed. Okay, the shaitan maybe comes to you, tells you why you are wasting your time. You should use this time to earn money, to enjoy your time. But subhanAllah, you are sitting here in front of your laptop or your mobile or your iPad, whatever. Okay, listening, writing, and also preparing for the exam. All of these things, okay, to increase your self-knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the scholar said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to increase himself in one thing only, which is the knowledge. Allah says in the Quran, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. He did not say, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي مَالًا أَوْ وَلَدًا. He did not tell the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh Allah, increase me, oh my Lord, increase me in wealth and children and happiness and knowledge, subhanAllah. Okay, let's continue. I know maybe this is the third class about the manners of dressing and adornment. It is very important. There is a point here that is it valid if you pray with something has pictures, photos of living things, and cross here in page 369. If one prays in clothing that has a picture of a cross or of a being that has a soul, is his prayer valid? It is forbidden to perform prayer in clothing that has a picture of a being that has a soul. It is not just during prayer. It is not allowed. Okay, but what about the salah? The salah is valid. It is not allowed. page 369. Now the point, how come we say it is haram to pray with something has pictures or a cross and the salah itself valid? Because as a rule, not only for this, if there is something forbidden inside the salah and outside the salah, then the salah will be valid. But if there is something specifically forbidden in the salah, then we tell this can affect the validity of the salah. Okay, so when we come to this issue, is it allowed to wear to put the cross or the pictures of photo of a living thing? And for example, a lion, a bird, we tell you this is haram, not allowed. Okay, so if you do this wrong, I mean, if you do this sin, then you went to the masjid or you prayed at home with this picture, your salah will be valid, inshallah. But the person will be a sinner because he used this pictures or his cross on his cloth. Number 10, at-tayammun, using the right side only or beginning with the right side. عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها said كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحب التيمم أو يعجب التيمم في تعنه وترجله وطهوره وشأنه كله. عائشة said رضي الله تعالى عنها the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم loved to use his right side. Okay, by beginning with it before the left side, or when only one side was required, such as in the case in regards to eating, he would use his right side in purifying himself, in combing his hair, and in putting on his shoes. And after that, he said, في شأنه كله. In everything, the Prophet ﷺ likes to start with the right. So this is hadith has something general and has something specific. Okay, maybe he did not mention this part of the hadith in this narration. وَفِي شَأْنِهِ كُلِّ and everything. Okay, so for example, I want to take the pen. I take the pen with my right hand. Okay, this is my right hand. Okay, the camera is the opposite. When I drink with my right hand. طيب. If I want to give someone something, I give him with my right hand. I take with my right hand. Okay, this is the sunnah. This is the sunnah. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم likes that. To start with the right or to use the right. And if you notice here, sisters, في طهوره. What's mean طهوره? When he makes the wudu. Okay, so I wash the right arm before the left arm. The right foot before the left foot. Okay, and but of course, if you want to wash your face, don't start with the right side of your face, then the left, right. Okay, you wash it together, and also the head. Okay, you wipe the head together. Don't you start with your right side, then your left side, because the right should be before the left if there are two parts. But here the and in the wudu, we wipe the head together and the face. But in combing and shaving the head, no, you start with the right. Okay, you start with that. Why? Yeah, because in shaving, it is not possible that you shave the whole head together. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did the Umrah or the Hajj, okay, he went to the barber, so he gave him his right side. Okay, again, sisters, this is my right side, okay? Because the camera opposite. So this is my right side, okay? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave his right side to the barber. So the barber shaved the hair of the right side. Then he gave the hair to Abu Talha. He gave the hair to Abu Talha. طيب. And then he shaved the left side of his head and he told Abu Talha, give this hair to other people. Of course, this is only for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yani, we should not do this. Yeah, for example, when I shave my head in the Umrah, okay, I tell my friends, yalla, take my hair as a blessing. No, this is only for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, not for anyone else after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, they did not do that. Okay, so the blessings only in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his sweat, his hair. His body alayhi salatu wasalam. Okay, what a rajul he, when you comb your hair, start with your right side. Okay, if you go to, yeah, for example, if there is a lady who comes to your house to comb your hair, maybe you are, yeah, you have a party, wedding party or something like this. So you tell this sister or this lady to start with your right side. Okay, and also tana'ulihi. When you put on the shoes, okay, start with the right. And when you remove them, you start with the left. You start with the left, and this is the next point. This is the next point on page 370. The sunnah for putting on shoes. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِذَنْ تَعَلَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَبْدَأْ بِالْيَمِينَ. When one of you puts on his shoes, then let him begin with the right foot. Allahu Akbar. And please, sisters, you can earn, you can get a gain, you can gain a lot of reward from many things, okay, yani without any extra effort. Yani like the sunnah, okay, you notice many Muslims don't care to start with the right or left. So subhanAllah, if we follow the sunnah, we will gain more reward. And also if you teach the others the sunnah, and from today, inshallah, from today, for those sisters who don't know the sunnah or they are not following the sunnah, please from today or from tonight, depends what is your country. When you put on your shoes, start with the right. When you take it off, start with your left. Do it until your family. May Allah reward all of us. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, and when he removes them, then let him begin with the left foot. The right is the first of them when shoes are put on, and the last of them when shoes are taken off. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam emphasized that. Okay, Allahu Akbar, yani, this is the beauty of Islam. Islam tells you everything, details, mashallah. And alhamdulillah, the importance of that. The next hadith, the Prophet said, if the boot strap or sandal thong of one of you breaks, then let him not walk in the other until he fixes it. So don't walk with one barefoot. What should I do? The next hadith, the Prophet said, let no one from you walk in one shoe. Either one should be barefooted and both feet, or attired with shoes in both feet. Subhanallah. Yani, you have to wear both of them, or you have to remove both of them. But walking with one of them, this is not sunnah. Why? Because we have a hadith. Okay, what is this hadith? The hadith here is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna al-shaytan yamshi fi al-na'l al-wahida." Okay, verily the shaytan, the devil, walks with only one shoe on. Allah Akbar. So we should avoid that, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't want us to follow the shaytan. We want to oppose the shaytan. We want to oppose the kuffar. طيب, so this is, subhanallah, we can say it's serious. There is a point here. The next point. Or before that, a nice point. Hadith Abdullah. A man from the companions, radiallahu ta'ala an, said in the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam ordered, the companion said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam ordered us to go barefoot sometimes. And nahtafi ahyana. So, يعني, for example, you are in a place, يعني, for example, you are in the desert, or you went with your family for a picnic, camp, okay, or for example, at home you have a garden. Okay, try to walk barefoot. Not always with the shoes. Now the system, sisters, and you can notice now many houses, maybe most of our houses, we wear our shoes even inside the house. Subhanallah. So we are far from the sunnah. So let's apply the sunnah. Don't think why, okay? Why it is only because because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that. Okay, I know some people try to, because if you wake barefoot, because there is some negative energy will leave your body, and they will give you explain. This is good for your tin, يعني, if you are tense and if you are angry, you will relax. Okay, this is not important for us. What is important, or let's say what is more important, is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that, and we need to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the point. طيب. Number 12. What to say upon wearing something new? Islam is with you. And the Prophet ﷺ wants you to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala step by step. Wow, I have a new dress, I have this. Okay, no need to say wow. It's remember the dua. Remember the dua, sisters. What is the dua? Allahumma laka alhamd. Anta kasawtani. As'aluka min khayri wa khayr ma suni ala. وعوذ بك من شره وشر ما صنع له الله أكبر. طيب, what is the hadith? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us to say certain supplications for the occasion of wearing something new. You say, oh Allah, for you is all praise. You have clothed me with it. I ask you for the good of it and the good for which it was made, and I seek refuge with you from the evil of it and the evil for which it was made. Subhanallah. This is the sunnah, sisters. Okay, when you have something new, new shirt, new abaya, new niqab, new hijab, say this dua. طيب, and also, there is another dua. الحمد لله الذي أطعمني هذا ورزقني من غير حمل ولا قوة Okay, and also Alhamdulillah الذي كساني هذا الثوب ورزقني من غير حول مني ولا قوة. If you remember, we mentioned this dua about the etiquettes of eating, and here also for clothing. Okay, and whoever, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in page 374, and whosoever wears a garment and then says, Alhamdulillah الذي كساني هذا الثوب, all praises to Allah who has clothed me with this garment and provided it for me with neither power for, nor might from myself, he is forgiven his previous sins and his previous sins. Okay, غفر له ما تقدم من ذنب. طيب, sorry, there is a point here. You notice between brackets he put and his later ones. Okay, he is forgiven his previous sins and his later ones. Okay, what is between brackets is not authentic. It's not authentic. طيب, what is between brackets is not authentic. يعني some scholars said all the ahadith which say that your sins, okay, he is forgiven his previous sins and his later sins, these are not authentic narration. What are the authentic narrations? Which has, he is forgiven his previous sins. Okay, so you'll find in many ahadith, okay, they add وَمَا تَأَخَّرْ, and also, sorry, مَا تَقَدَّمْ وَمَنْهُ مَا تَأَخَّرْ, and his later ones. Okay, but this here, it is not authentic. Maybe Wallahu A'lam, what we have only one hadith about, okay, what is before and what is after, in fasting Arafah. In fasting Arafah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that 1 year Allah will forgive 1 year in advance and 1 year previously. So this narration, this word in this narration is not authentic. The hadith is authentic, but this addition is not authentic. What we say to the person who has new garment? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Umar, this garment of yours is recently washed or new? Umar said, rather, it is washed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, okay, there is another narration, new. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, ilbis jadidan wa ish hamidan wa mutshahidan, wear a new, live commendably and die a martyr. Okay, wallahi, sisters, yani, when we read this hadith, imagine if we have this concept, and this is common among the sisters and also the brothers and also in the family. Okay, if you wear something new, I say dua for you, and also you yourself, you say dua. If one of us sneeze, we say, he should say alhamdulillah, we reply alhamdulillah, he should reply again, before we eat, bismillah. When we finish, we say alhamdulillah. Wake up, we say alhamdulillah. We go to bed, we say bismillah. Yani we live with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, the remembrance of Allah. Then the shaitan will not come close to you. The shaitan will not approach you. You can protect yourself from these adhkar. So many sisters, many brothers complain, I see nightmares, I see this, okay, or I feel bad, I have an anxiety, depression, okay, many times because they are very far from remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if we remember Allah, we read Quran, we say our adhkar, Allah will be with us, and also Allah will protect us. طيب. Also another hadith for the one who, if you see someone wearing something new, we say, Tubli wa yukhlifullah. There is a hadith. Okay, it is a long hadith, but let's take this part only from the hadith. Khalid bint Khalid, radiallahu ta'ala. Now, a very young girl, Ibn Sa'id, radiallahu ta'ala. A number of garments were brought to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and among them was a small black khamisa, a garment that is stripped with silk or wool. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, who you do think we should clothe with this? So they did not say anything. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, bring Khalid. Bring Khalid. So they brought Khalid. Okay, bring Khalid. radiallahu ta'ala, who was a little girl at that time, she was carried to him. What do you understand, sisters? She was carried to him. She was a young, very young girl. Yeah, and maybe she was 6 months, 8 months, maybe something 1 year. Yeah, and she was young. She was not walking, maybe. She was young. So after which, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, took the khamisa with his hand and attired her in it. Allahu Akbar. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, put the cloth. Yani he fixed the cloth for Khalid. Then he said to Khalid, Abli wa akhliqi. Abli wa akhliqi. May you wear it out and akhliqi. An expression that is intended as a supplication for a long life until the clothes are worn out and end up in tatters. Yani, yes, it is a dua that, yani, it is like a supplication. This statement, it is supplication for this person. Yani, may you live long time until you use this dress and it become, yani, spoiled. And, yani, throw it and use another one. Yani, you don't die before using this this cloth. And also, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it had a green or yellow emblem on it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Khalid, oh Khalid, this is sana in Ethiopian for good. Of course, this hadith in Bukhari, it has many things. Okay. But what I like here, yes. Now the point is you make dua for the person who has this dress, new dress. You say, abli wa akhliq. If a man, abli wa akhliq. If a woman, abli wa akhliqi, you add ya. Okay? I think because you study Arabic, if you are talking to a man, you say abli wa akhliq. Okay? But if you are talking to a woman, you say abli wa akhliqi. طيب? I like here to emphasize a point, which is give respect for the children. Sisters, if you notice here in this hadith, it was a young girl. Khalid was a little girl. The Prophet ﷺ gave her a kunya, nickname. He said, Khalid, the mother of Khalid. She is not married. She doesn't have children, of course. Okay, but he said, Khalid. Why? As a respect. So we need this way, sisters. Okay, how to respect our children. If you call them, use a good name. Don't use the names of animals, all the animals. If I'm calling my son or my daughter, I use all the animal names, except his name or her name. Okay, use his name. Okay, come. His name is Abdullah, Muhammad, Khalid, Ahmed, Sa'ad. Okay, her name is Aisha, Fatima, Kamila, Jamila, Hind. Use the name of your children. Try to respect them. This is very important, brothers and sisters. Number 13, it is recommended to wear white clothing. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Ilbasu min thiyabikum al-bayad." Ilbasu min thiyabikum al-bayad. Wear your white colored clothes, for they are purer and better. طيب فإن من خير ثيابكم وكفنوا فيها موتاكم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "Ilbasu min thiyabikum bayad, فإن من خير ثيابكم وكفنوا فيها موتاكم." Another narration, فإنها أطهر وأطيب. فإنها أطهر وأطيب. Okay, يعني what is the point that it is purer? The scholars try to explain this because if my dress white, okay, so if there is any dot, there is something like this. Okay, maybe you can notice here. There is a small dot here. Okay, I can notice. Why? Because it is white. But imagine if it is a black or brown, difficult, or sometimes it is difficult to see the dirt. So for the white color, okay, for the white color, it is very much easier for me to find the dirt and then I can clean it. So that's why it is a purer. That's why it is a purer, as the scholars mentioned. On the other hand, it is forbidden to wear for the man al-mu'asfar, الثوب المعصفر. طيب. And in contrast to this recommended attire, there are certain colors in clothing that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم forbade. Abdullah ibn Am ibn al-As رضي الله عنهما, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saw upon me two معصفر garments. معصفر garment is one that is dyed in yellow. However, Ibn Hajar said, most معصفر garments are dyed in red. So it is something in between. العصفر, you know, العصفر is a kind of plant like زعفران. Okay, like the زعفران. The color almost like the زعفران. يعني it is red, orange, something like this. Or very shiny orange. Okay, so the Prophet ﷺ said to Abdullah ibn Amr, verily, these are from the garments of the disbelievers, so don't wear them. So for the man, he should avoid wearing al-mu'asfar. He should avoid wearing al-mu'asfar. Okay. And also here he mentioned the red color. He mentioned the red color. Yani he said, it is not allowed to wear the red color. Sorry, where he mentioned this. Yani he said fully color, fully red color. But he said here, we know of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibition of wearing clothing that is replete with the color red. However, there is an authentic hadith in which Al-Bara said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was of medium height, and I indeed saw him wearing a red robe, and I have not seen anything better than it. So here he tried to say how to join between these two ahadith, but Al-Albani rahimahullah said, this is a clear hadith and authentic hadith that it is allowed for the man to wear something red. And then Al-Albani said, وَلَا يَصِحُّ شَيْءٍ مِنَ الْحَدِيثِ النَّهِيَ عَنِ لِبَاسِ الْأَحْمَرِ. And there is no hadith, there is no single authentic hadith tells us it is forbidden to wear the red color. And to claim that the Prophet was wearing something red, but it was not purely red, it is mixed, this is not correct. Okay, as Shawkani rahimahullah mentioned. So the point here that all the Sheikh Al-Albani said, all the hadith which said it is forbidden to wear the red, they are not authentic. And we have, on the other hand, we have a hadith, authentic hadith in Bukhari, that the Prophet wore something red. So it is allowed for the man to wear the red according to the authentic hadith. According to authentic hadith. طيب. Number 14. What kind of rings men may wear? يعني the Prophet had a ring. It is permissible for men to wear rings made of silver, not gold, because gold is forbidden for the man. We mentioned that. It was allowed, then it became forbidden. But it is forbidden for them to wear rings made of gold. And if a man does wear a ring, it is recommended for him to wear it on his tiny finger. Tiny finger. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّ اتَّخَذْنَا خَاتَمًا وَقَشْنَا فِيهِ نَقْشًا. Okay, verily we have taken a ring and we have made an inscription on it. طيب, it was written Muhammad Rasulullah. And on the ring of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some scholars said it was written Allah, Muhammad, Rasul. The order, the opposite. Allah, Muhammad, Rasul. But يعني some scholars said we don't have proof for that. We should take it as it came in the hadith. It is written Muhammad, Rasulullah. Muhammad, Rasulullah. The order from up to down. Muhammad Rasulullah. So it is allowed for the man to use the ring. You can wear the ring in your the little finger or the ring finger. This is allowed. طيب, but the man should avoid this finger. The man should avoid this finger, this is the thumb and the index. Okay. Why? Because as it came in the hadith, Ali radiallahu ta'ala said, Nahani, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم جعل خاتم على هذه والتي تليها. على هذه والتي تليها. طيب. Sorry, the index and the middle. The index and the middle. Where is Hadith Ali? Ali radiallahu anhu said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade me, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade me from wearing my ring on this finger or on the one next to it. It means the middle and the index. The middle and the index. Okay, this is forbidden for the man. Okay, yani they mentioned this is for the man. So, some scholars mentioned this is a lot for the woman, but for the man, we tell him don't wear the ring for your index and for your middle finger. Okay, where you put your ring in the little or the ring finger. And also, it's okay to wear the ring with your right hand or with your left hand. You put the ring here or here. This is allowed. This is allowed. Also, he mentioned here, number 15, it is recommended to wear fragrance. To wear fragrance. What is the hadith? Anas radiallahu ta'ala an said, I have never touched any silk or dibaj, a kind of silk, which is the thick silk, that was softer than the hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I have never smelled any fragrance or scent that was better than the fragrance or scent of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to have a very nice smell. He used to have a very nice smell, and this is for the men, for the brothers. Okay, if you go to the masjid, put some oud, some rose, some yani perfume. Let your smell be nice. And also when you are coming home to your wife, to your family, okay, let your smell be nice. Okay, but for the sisters, for you as sisters, it is not allowed to put perfume and you go outside. You go to your job and you go to your company and you go to the street and the market. Or for the women, we tell them this is strictly forbidden. Okay, one of the sisters asked me last week, can I put something very light, yani? This is okay. I mean, the point is, if you, yeah, for example, you put something here for on your neck, okay, yeah, and it's little of maybe a rose or something, musk, okay, and you put your hijab, you put your niqab, you put your abaya. So if you walk outside, no one can smell your perfume. This is okay. What is haram that if you put the perfume and people outside can smell your perfume. Okay, but as I said, you put something here, you put the deodorant and it has a nice smell, but people cannot smell this. This is okay, but you should be very careful. Make sure that the men cannot smell your perfume. Okay. Number 16, السنه في ترجيل الشعر وحلقه. And sorry, and for this about the sisters. Okay, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as for any woman that wears perfume and then passes by a group of men so that they can smell her fragrance, then she is a fornicator. Subhanallah. Yani, this is a scary hadith, which means it is a major sin. It is a major sin. Of course, it doesn't mean she is a fornicator that we have to stone this lady, but the sin is a major sin. It is not something simple. And also, if you are going to the masjid, sisters, if you are going to the masjid, don't put the perfume. Don't put the perfume. Number 16. The sunnah pertaining to a person's hair. جابر عبد الله رضي الله تعالى عنهما said, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam once visited us in our home, he saw a man with this disheveled hair. He sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, could he not have found something to comb his hair with? And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw a man who was wearing dirty clothes. He sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, could he not have found something to wash his clothes with? And also Abu Huraira narrated the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, man kana lahu sha'r falyukrim. If a person has hair, which means a long hair yani, on his head, then let him honor it. Okay, yani, you should take care. Yani, don't leave your hair without combing, you put shampoo, some oil. Okay, but of course for the man, not every day. For the man, not every day. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, here if you notice, نهانا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يمتشط أحدنا كل يوم. طيب. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم forbade that one of us should comb his hair every day. Yeah, the scholars mentioned this is for the man. يعني for me, I am a man. So every day, before going to my work, I am combing my hair, putting oil, maybe 15 minutes, okay, watching myself in the mirror, checking with my mobile, my hair is good here. Okay, this is for the woman doing this for her the husband. Okay, for the man, for the man, every day I'm spending maybe half an hour, okay, 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes afternoon, 10 minutes at night. Okay, no, we should not do this. We should not do this. Maybe you do this for the Jum'ah prayer. Okay, I check myself. Okay, my ghutra is okay, my beard is okay, I put the oil, but not every day. Maybe every other day. Which is called ghibban. This is came in the hadith. Naha an tarajjul illa ghibban. Okay. Naha an tarajjul illa ghibban. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade the practice of combing one's hair unless it is done at reasonable intervals. Okay, yani the point is not every day for the man. You should not do this every day. You are a man. Every day I put oil for my beard. Oh. Okay, maybe every other day or once a week or every 3 days, something like that. There is a point that which is better you for the man, of course, to shave the head or you leave your hair, because we have some hadith that the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam up to the ears. Some hadith up to the shoulder. Okay, so يعني, what is the point? Okay, he mentioned here, it's better that you leave your hair. It's better to leave your hair. Okay, why? Because you notice that the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ has long hair. But if you come to the Hajj or Umrah, I mean as a man, then you have to shave or you shorten your hair. And that's why we notice that different hadith, sometimes the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the ears, up to the shoulder or in between, because this is it far from the Hajj or Umrah or close to the Hajj or Umrah. Imam Ahmed said, rahimahullah, this is sunnah, and if we can take care of that, I will do it. Yani Imam Ahmed was not leaving his hair long. Why? Because he said this is sunnah, but yani this takes time, okay, and needs effort to take care of my hair and yani to tie it or to do something like this. And also we should be careful, sisters. This is also important because for those who have boys, نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن القزع. نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن القزع. It is forbidden to shave one's hair if one shaves it as an act of worship. Okay. This is another point. Okay. If you believe shaving the head is a worship, then this is haram. Why you shave your head? No. It is better and it is sunnah. No. Then we'll tell you this is haram. To worship Allah by shaving the head, it is only in the Hajj and Umrah. Okay, and subhanAllah, this is one of the signs of the Khawarij. This is one of the signs of the Khawarij. But for example, because I am busy, okay, it's safe for me because I'm working in a place, it's dangerous, the hair of the head. Okay, of course, not the beard, shave the head. Okay, it's okay. What about al-qaza'? To shave part of the head and you leave the part, the other part. This is forbidden. This is forbidden, which is called al-qaza'. You shave part of the head and you leave the other part. Or you shave the sides and you leave the top. Or you shave the top and you leave the sides. This is forbidden because this is called al-qaza', and the Prophet forbade doing al-qaza'. He forbade from doing al-qaza'. Yani, wallahi, I feel sorry, sisters, when I see some of the sisters or some of the parents, they do this with their boys. They shave the sides and they leave the top. Okay, and there is a clear hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also number 17, this is for the men. It is for the men, which is it is wajib for the man to grow the beard. It is wajib for the man. So please tell your husbands, tell your parents, sorry, fathers, tell your sons, tell your brothers, okay, to grow the beard. This is wajib in Islam, and some scholars mention ijma' consensus that it is forbidden to shave the beard. Okay, so growing the beard is wajib. Growing the beard is wajib. And the sunnah is to cut the mustache. Okay, yani, the main thing is to remove what grows on the lips, upper lips. The sunnah to remove it. Or if you like to take it, the mustache for the man, okay, don't take it by the blade, okay? You should keep something. You should keep something. Okay, so this is for the mustache. For the beard, okay, yes, some scholars or many scholars say it is allowed to cut some of the beard, but it should be more than the, يعني, the qabda, okay? You cut your beard and you keep only 1 centimeter, alaykum salam. No, this is not allowed. It's not allowed. Okay. But many scholars said it's okay if your beard is thick. So you cut what is more than the fist. Okay, like this. What is more than the fist, and you cut this. Okay. If you cut this, many scholars said this is okay. Why? Because we have act from some companions, Abu Huraira, Abu Sa'id Khudri, Abdullah ibn Umar, and also Ibrahim Nakhai said they were cutting from their beard, which means more than the fist. Okay. The sunnah to dye white hair, but not to the color black. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Verily, the Jews and Christians don't dye their hair, so differ from them in regard to this matter and in regard to all matters." Okay, so if my beard now black, okay, khalas, I don't dye my beard, which is black. But if there is hair, white hair, gray hair, so the sunnah to change this color. The sunnah to change this color. Okay, but I should avoid the black color. I should avoid the black color. Okay, why? Because in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, change this when the father of Abu Bakr, Abu Quhafa radiyallahu anhu, when he was abroad, his beard was totally white. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, change this with something, but stay away from black. So please, sisters, you are maybe 45 years old, or maybe you are 42. The white hair started, not in your beard, yani, your head. Okay, for many sisters, yani, it is a shock for them. There is one white hair. There is second, the third. She becomes very sad. Okay, why you become sad? Alhamdulillah. It is white or it is black. Alhamdulillah. Yani, I spent my life in worshiping Allah. Alhamdulillah. Okay. You don't like the shape of this white hair. Okay, no problem. Change this color. But please, please, please avoid the white color. Avoid the white color. You can use the red. You put henna. It is red. Maybe you can mix the henna with something. It will be dark brown, a brown, some dark gray. It's okay. Avoid the black color. خلاص. This is يعني what came in the hadith. And this hadith is sahih Muslim. Yes, there is different opinions, but to stick to the hadith, we will be safe. To stick to the hadith will be safe. طيب. Number 19, what is related about the using of kuhl, okay, which is called al-ithmid, okay, which is called al-ithmid. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خير أكحالكم الإثمد يجلو البصر وينبت الشعر. يجلو البصر وينبت الشعر. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best of your kuhl. Okay, kuhl, yeah, something you put here, like eyeliner, يعني, something like eyeliner, kuhl, is al-ithmid, a kind of kuhl, which comes from a well-known black stone that has some redness in it. It is found in the land of al-Hijaz. Okay, what is the benefit of al-kuhl, this kind of kuhl? It strengthens and improves eyesight and makes hair grow. طيب. So those who like the eye, يعني the hair to grow in a nice way, they can use al-ithmid, this kind of kuhl. This kind of kuhl. So this is يعني from the sunnah of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم to use this kind of kuhl. طيب. And يعني it's okay for men and women. This is okay for men and women. But يعني he said here, if the man is using this as a beauty, we tell him no. We tell him no. Okay. So use it as a treatment or to strengthen your vision, but not as beautification. Not as beautification. طيب. ما يحرم من الزينة على النساء. Kinds of adornment that are prohibited for women. Okay. We have the hadith, very important hadith, which is Bukhari and others have related from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and that Allah cursed al-wasila, a woman who attaches her from a foreign source to her own hair. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud cursed al-wasila, okay, the one who add hair to another woman. طيب الواصلة. This is الواصلة. Those women, الواشمة. The hadith started with الواشمات. Those women who stick needles in skin and then fill the area with كحل or bluing to make the skin blue or green. Tattoo. واشمة. The one who is doing this. Okay, of course, the hadith means al-washim, which is to inject something under the skin. Okay, to inject something under the skin. They don't mean, you know, sometimes you put a sticker. Okay, we don't mean this by the hadith. We mean because the sticker, خلاص, you remove it and it's okay, alhamdulillah. But the problem with injecting this green color, blue color, this is major sin. The one who's doing that and the one who's done for him, man or woman, of course. والمستوشمات, those women who demand others. Okay. الواشمات والمتشمات والمتنمصات. Okay. المتنمصات, those women who demand others to remove or pluck the hair on their face. Okay. This is also one of the major sins, to remove, to pluck the hair of the eyebrows. Okay, and also يعني, the scholars mentioned this is not only for the eyebrows, for the whole face. This is, please sisters, this is one of the major sins, and this is serious. While you are looking for the beauty in doing haram things, you should avoid that. If you want to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, or if you want to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and please don't try to find fatwa. If you try to find the fatwa, you'll find. If you go to to the internet, finding a fatwa, okay, I want a sheikh who's saying this is halal, you will find that. Subhanallah. Now even you'll find a sheikh who's telling you it is okay to drink alcohol. You'll find a sheikh who's saying it's okay to take riba. So you should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and look for the evidence, the dalil, the proof from the Quran and Sunnah, and also from our great scholars. So this is one of the major sins. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those women who demand from someone to create a gap between their two front teeth, or those who do it themselves. Okay, you know, when you make some women, okay, and also some men, they like to make gaps between the teeth. Of course, the front teeth, because people see these teeth. Why? They look nice. So doing that, looking for the beauty, haram. Okay. المغيرات خلق الله. Okay. They want to change the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please, sister, I'm not talking about I'm going to the dentist because I have a problem, so the doctor needs to remove part of my teeth, part of my tooth, okay, to fix the crown or tooth. Okay. This is as a treatment, this is allowed. Okay. But we see the woman in the street. For example, there is an advertisement, a woman with a very nice teeth. Then I say, Allah, I want to be like this lady. How? I go to the doctor and he will do cosmetic treatment. This is haram, looking for the beauty. This is haram. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be sure that your creation is nice. And of course, this is not only for the women, also for the men, if they are doing the same. Jazakumullah khair, sister. We have maybe 5 minutes because in Kuwait, Maghrib Adhan will come after about 5 or 6 minutes. So we'll have your questions, inshallah. Let's see the questions. Where are the questions? Okay. Can we whiten our teeth? We should be careful. If it is for beautifying the teeth and you need to remove the surface of your teeth, okay, we should be careful, we should avoid that. But for example, whitening, maybe they put something to look white and nice, okay. And please, again, you should when you are doing this kind of beautifying, you should cover your face. The rule is you cover your face. Isn't it allowed to upper lip hair for ladies? Sorry, I did not understand. Can women wear adar? Sorry, what is adar? I have a lot of hair loss. Any treatment for tib al-nabawi? Well, I don't know. But for the eyebrows, we have the al-ithmid, this kuhl al-ithmid. We have kuhl al-ithmid. And generally, olive oil is baraka. Olive oil, it is from a blessed tree. Can we remove fascia hair? I mean, mustache. For women, if the mustache grows, okay, you remove. Why? Because the mustache for the men, not for the women. So you shave it. Okay, you know, subhanAllah, some women, maybe they have a problem with the hormones. So she looks like a man with the mustache. So she can shave the mustache. It's not allowed to remove upper lip hair for ladies. Okay, you mean the mustache, huh? Sheikh, what about the hair on the upper lip? Is wearing cartoon characters on your clothes haram? Okay. For a lady, for an adult lady, we should avoid that. We should avoid that, the pictures. But you know, if, يعني, because you know, the picture is like a living thing, like an enemy. We should avoid that. But you know, sometimes it is like a car with eyes. Then this is okay. Why? Because it is not a living thing. Okay, or an orange with nose and okay, this is okay. But يعني, please, sister, يعني, it doesn't look nice that for a sister who is half of the Quran. Okay, she يعني, okay, even among the women, okay, she's wearing something with a cartoon shape. Please, sister, يعني, we should not think only about the haram and halal. She give us the limit. Also, what is recommended? We need to get the respect from the people. Can you wear braces for teeth? I don't know. Is it allowed for a female to remove hair from the rest of the face, leaving the eyebrows? As we mentioned, the hadith is Namisa. They said specifically it is about the eyebrows, but it includes the whole face. Okay, so removing the hair, small hair from here, we should avoid that. I mean, from under the eye like this also, we should avoid that. Can we wear braces on pages to push it back and beautiful? Okay, please, يعني, beautifying that, we should avoid that. But if the doctor said you need to do that as a treatment, the braces as a treatment. Why? Because if one tooth front, one back, one like this, okay, you have problem with eating, okay, so as a treatment, do it, but to look nice, okay, يعني, الله أعلم, يعني, to do that. Can we laser hair removal on face? We should avoid that. يعني, you remove your eyebrows, you should avoid that. Can we wear slippers at home? Yes, you can wear slippers at home. But يعني, my point when I mentioned this, not always. Try to walk barefoot, like the Prophet ﷺ, he said. Any color specification for women? Why abaya and black always? It is not always black. Not always black. Maybe it can be dark. يعني, for example, here in Kuwait, what is common? Black. Also in Saudi Arabia, it is black. Okay, but maybe I noticed there, and I went to UK, they are using another color, maybe dark blue, dark brown. This is okay. And Africa, colorful, because this is common and not considered as beautification. Sorry, sisters, we'll stop, inshallah. You can send your questions. Assalamu alaikum.